officially titled my talk today, Beyond White Racism, Beyond Civil Rights, Human Rights, and Into African Revolution. I'm going to center on the concept of revolution today. And I will tell you why, because I'm sure some of you will think that that's somewhat passe to be talking about revolution. That was something people talked about in the 60s and the 70s. And why talk about it now? But I think and I hope that as a result of what I have to say here today, you might change your opinion about that particular topic. I'd like to, of course, commend you for your celebration of African history, of African American history. And of course, we recognize the importance of studying such history. However, I think we still underestimate the value of the study of African history. I think we celebrate it without analyzing it. We search it and look for heroes without understanding that one of its major purposes is to teach us lessons on how to cope with the present and with the future. Not only are those people who do not know their history doomed to repeat it, but those who often misread it are often doomed to repeat it as well. And those who misread and perhaps fail to read it at all may not have a chance to repeat it at all. And I think we have reached this point where our failure to understand history is going to put us in a position where we won't have a chance to learn it again. The survival of our people is at the crossroads today. And our study of history then should be about more than celebrating our heroes, about more than celebrating the struggles, than just keeping eyes on the prize. And those are valuable things, obviously. But we must look at history in terms of coming to understand our current and our future obligations and what must be accomplished by those things. If we're not careful, we will be beguiled by our study of history. Many of us who have not studied, for instance, Reconstruction history, the history of the United States, particularly of African Americans during the 1860s and 70s, may think that we are entering a new era in American history. We may think that the things that we're witnessing today, the elections of blacks to political office and their appointment to various positions, their activities in various corporations and so forth, is something new in American history. And yet, a study of Reconstruction history will quickly convince us that we are currently undergoing deja vu. Many of us see history as a continuing progress upward and onward. We have bought the American concept of progress, the idea that things must, over time, necessarily get better. There is no law in the universe that tells you that your future survival is assured, that you will continue to exist now and into the future. There have been races and ethnic groups who have been virtually wiped out on this planet, and there is no guarantee that your own group will not be wiped out as well. The idea then that you must necessarily arrive at a point greater than those of your ancestors could possibly be an illusion. The idea that somehow through some great automation you are going to be in a better condition than your people is an illusion often of not studying history and recognizing that progressions and regressions occur in history, that integrations and disintegrations occur in history. History is not a fairy tale where certain things are accomplished and then people live happily ever after. And many of us think then that the accomplishments that we've made up to this point means that we are only going to expand them in the future. I think you had better think about that again. And I'll point out today why we must not be so optimistic as to be foolish. In fact, let us go back for a moment to an article written in the Ebony Magazine, October 1981, wherein Lerone Bennett, who wrote the book Black Power USA, I think wrote his conclusion to the book. When I read that book, Black Power USA, and I guess it was published back in, what, the 60s maybe, or 70s, at least early 70s, and I finished reading it, I said, the last chapter of this book is missing. You know, and it went on to laud Black Power during the Reconstruction era and so forth, and yet somehow the logical conclusions were not drawn at the end of that book. The lessons that that book implied were not expressed openly and completely. And consequently then, I think some people would have been left with the wrong impression. But lo and behold, he did write the final chapter, but not in the book itself, but in the magazine. The second Reconstruction is history repeating itself. This is October 1981. And he titled it, as you can see here, The Second Time Around. Will history repeat itself and rob blacks of the gains of the 1960s? So he's dealing with the issue again here. We gained it once and we lost it. Is there any law in the universe that says we will not lose it again? And I like the introduction here. He starts out by saying, over. It was at last, at long last, over and done with. How could anyone doubt it? How could anyone fail to see that the race problem had been solved forever? One man who had no doubt said, all distinctions founded upon race or color have been forever abolished in the United States. Another who saw things this way said the category of race had been abolished by law and that there were no more colored people in this country. Thus spoke the dreamers and the prophets and victims in the first Reconstruction of the 1860s and the 1870s. I don't think I have to elaborate on this kind of attitude. We run into too many youngsters today who said, oh, that was in slavery time. Oh, those were the things that you talked about in the 60s. That's the 60s and the 70s. We're in a new day now. You're not in a new day, ladies and gentlemen. The same words that we were saying today, the same word that we're saying today, the same words that people said over 100 years ago. Why are we in a new day when we're saying the same thing that someone said 100 years ago? He goes on to say, and it is worth emphasizing here at the very beginning that these flights into fantasy were based on the same hard facts that gripped the imagination of blacks in the second Reconstruction of the 1960s and 70s. There was, for example, a black man in the U.S. Senate in the 1870s, and there was a black governor in Louisiana. In the 1860s and the 1870s, as in the 1960s and 1970s, there were black sheriffs and mayors in the South. And there was open speculation about a black vice presidential candidate. So the Jesse run is not new in black American history, ladies and gentlemen. There was moreover a network of civil rights laws that seemed to settle the issue beyond all possibility of dispute or recall. Same kind of situation we talked about here today, when you try to tell our people that laws don't protect anyone. And there are so many of us who believe that fair housing laws and anti-discrimination laws and civil rights laws and voting laws and so forth guarantee our freedom. What an illusion. What a flight into fantasy. Laws are no stronger than their enforcers. And the same people who pass those laws are the same people who are responsible for enforcing the law. And if the people then who enforce the law no longer decide to do so, the laws then are of no value and have no power. Ultimately then, fairness rests and the fairness of treatment rests not in laws, but in the activities of people and in the attitude and consciousness of people. And if people who are responsible for enforcing those laws change their attitudes, then the treatment of those people whose freedom is protected by those so-called laws is now changed as well. You cannot put your faith in a white man's law and in laws enforced by whites. I have warned people many times that if it comes one day where the society has to make a choice between feeding white children and feeding black children, no amounts of civil rights laws or any other laws on the books will prevent those people from feeding their children first. It is a silly faith that we have then in laws. And for people in the 1970s and 80s and 90s to still rest their freedom on the basis of laws, when the very history itself shows us that this cannot be done, we must question their sanity and what they have learned from the study of that history. There was, moreover, a network of civil rights laws, they said, that seemed to settle the issue beyond all possibility of dispute or recall. Back there, 100 years ago, there was a federal law protecting voting rights in the South. Does this all sound vaguely familiar? And there was a national public accommodations law. So the public accommodations law didn't begin with the Freedom Rides, ladies and gentlemen, in the 1960s. We had those back there in the 1860s and 70s as well. So such, in broad outline, was the racial situation 100 years ago in the 1860s and 1870s, when racism was forever abolished in America for the first time. It was a short forever. And of course, I'm not going to read you the whole piece, but there are just segments in here I want to sort of quote, such as, almost every schoolboy knows, the first Reconstruction ended in a major historical catastrophe that wiped out the gains of the 1860s. As a consequence, it required 100 years and oceans of blood for black people to climb back into the political plateau they have occupied in the 1860s and 70s. So, as I stated earlier, history contains both progress and regress. However, I think regress at this point of history will not be a situation where we will be able to fight a battle all over again. I think regress at this point of history essentially spells annihilation for Africans, not only in America, but for Africans the world over. For as I said, he went on to say in Black Power USA, and as Du Bois said before me in Black Reconstruction, Reconstruction in all of its various facets was a supreme lesson for America, the right reading of which might still mark a turning point in our history. So consequently then, as I stated earlier, we must read the history correctly. The mere approaching of history in terms of the celebrating of personalities to a good degree, while important, is also a misreading of history as well. We must not only celebrate Martin Luther King and the others, we must look at the lessons that history teaches us. He mentions here a war on poverty that went on in the 1860s and 70s, the Freedmen's Bureau. And putting on the book Civil Rights Laws, which were in some instances stronger than the civil rights laws passed in the 1960s and 70s. In the wake of these events, there was an explosive growth in black consciousness. And the blacks made political gains which surpassed in many instances the political gains black made in the 1960s and 70s. A lesson that says what, ladies and gentlemen? That the election of black men and women does not secure the salvation of African people. And that the election of black mayors and governors and your getting job for white corporation in no way assures the survival of black people. And we cannot make then the progress of black people synonymous with your qualifying for degrees and your getting jobs downtown. And we must wake up to this possibility, because we've had this game played on us before. At one time, in fact, black legislators were in the majority in the South Carolina legislature. In the same period as in the comparable period in the 1960s and 70s, poor whites received social and economic benefits rich whites had denied them. Once we got in, we were even good to the poor folks. We set up public school systems and a whole lot of other things. The key element, and he goes on then to talk about various other things here, but I think we should keep in mind here a number of things. If you have a chance, read this particular article, because I think it's very, very important. And this, I'll conclude by reading this. Long discussions about the morals and educational qualifications of blacks obscure the main point. Power or the lack of power. I want to repeat this. Power or the lack of power. The worst thing that can be said about some leaders of the Reconstruction period is that they did not seem to understand that the only issue was power. We don't talk about that issue very much today even. It seems to frighten many of us. One final point is relevant to an understanding of the power realities of the social movements of both the first and second Reconstructions. In both cases, social and political leaders failed to provide the economic balance that made political balance viable. No one understood this better than the black masses of the 1860s, who said in marches and demonstrations that their freedom was not secure without a firm economic foundation. So I think again then, when we look and celebrate Frederick Douglass and Harriet Tubman and others, we should again look at the essential issues. If, as I will emphasize a bit later on here, your education in this institution is not about gaining real power, not jobs, because your jobs do not represent power. Not getting elected, that does not represent power either. Buying your houses and fine clothes does not represent power. If it is not about real power, you are being miseducated and misled, and you will die educated and misled. If your study of black history is merely an exercise in feeling good about yourself, then you will die feeling good. The study of history then must be more than the pumping up of your self-esteem and the pumping up of your pride. Those things are important, but ultimately those things are not the means by which we will save ourselves as people in this world. We must understand the tremendous value of the study of history for the gaining of power. That's why we study history. History has very practical outcomes and very practical meanings. Why is it, do you think, that the other people object to your putting in an African curriculum in New York City schools? Huh? Do you think it's merely because they hate you? Merely because they don't know your history? merely because they're prejudiced? If you think so, you're sadly mistaken. Because these people know, I think, better than we do, that a sound approach to history represents an empowerment of a people, not merely the making them feel good or not. And I read a long piece this summer in the New York Times about the efforts of many blacks to push the African curriculum on college campuses, particularly in California. And of course, one of the white instructors there indicated very clearly that this is about power. They recognize it right away. This is about power, not just about including black people in the curriculum. This, the way this history will be taught and projected, represents who will be in power and who will rule whom in this world today. So consequently, as we raise the issue in New York State about the inclusionary situation, you will see then the aspects of white supremacy raising its ugly head. Some of you, I'm sure, are familiar with the current so-called controversy. In the City Sun this week, there is an article called Regents Face Controversial Report on Minorities. And the writer here, David Bowder, is writing, makes some quotations from letters received by the Regents and others objecting to the inclusions of African history and other people's history into the educational curricula of the state of New York. One woman worried about the destruction of our Western culture. And she recognized the destruction of our Western culture. Another woman criticized the Regents for a disgraceful anti-white proposal. The inclusion of the truth about African people in history represents an anti-white proposal. On a certain level, though, she's not wrong. And on a certain level, the statement about the destruction of Western culture is not wrong. Because Western culture, the enslaver of African people, the destroyer of African people, the degrader of African people, should be destroyed. White people, the degraders of African people and enslavers and killers and murderers of African people should be removed from power. I will talk to you later. A lot of you want to play games with your minds and hide behind words like racism, as if racism can exist by itself in some kind of vacuum, and as if it is not something that must be acted out by real flesh and blood people. You know, it's like when people talk about the economy. It's almost like saying the economy. There are people involved in economic activities, real people. White racism is not a concept. It is active people engaged in a certain type of interaction with other people. And if you are to remove racism, you must remove their capacity to engage in these activities. You got to face it up front. But they have you now fighting abstractions when the reality is still destroying you. And we're going to come back to this in a minute. One wrote, maybe we need the Klan back. Of course, they haven't gone, really. And he described himself as a veteran, a voter, and a taxpayer. Tony Brown, of course, mentioned, Tony Brown did a show, a series of shows here locally some weeks back. And as a result of that, he wrote that many white friends think that black people don't pay taxes. You know, they don't think black people have been to war. And the whole bit. So this guy writes, as a veteran, a voter, and a taxpayer. Somehow, you know, we don't do these things. Raising the Specter of Racism in Education, the task force, that is the task force that wrote the report, said New York's history courses overemphasize the contributions of white Europeans and minimize the accomplishment of minorities and largely ignores wrongs committed by whites against others. Critics accuse the task force of trying to drive a wedge between the races. What a game. Oh, we've been together all this time, I guess. They say the state's education leaders should be more concerned with crumbling schools, high dropout rates, and drug addiction, as if these things are not related to the other things. Columnist George Will ended the report, called the report affirmative action run amok. He said the perverse attempts to purge American culture of Eurocentrism ignored the fundamental truth that the central ideas behind American institutions come from Europe. Says that's exactly the point. They come from Europe. I think the report should be thrown away. Diane Ravitch, a history professor at Columbia University's Teachers College, the premier teachers college, right? The one that you all are so proud to get your degrees from? The American Federation of Teachers President Albert Shanker, condemning the report's finding, labeled it the Sobol report, that is the commissioner, state commissioner. A recent profile of Governor Mario Cuomo in New York Magazine cited the report in dismissing Sobol as one of Cuomo's less than brilliant commissioners, and so forth. So why are these people objecting then to history and the history of African people? We must recognize then, ladies and gentlemen, that history is more than merely remembering one's past. That history is a very practical thing. Those of you in psychology no doubt have studied the abnormality referred to as amnesia. And if you haven't, look it up and see the effects amnesia has on different various patients. You think often that not knowing your history in no way harms you, but certainly it does. As a matter of fact, you are more a victim of history by not knowing it than in knowing it. What happened to African people during the slavery period is pressingly present in the youngest black child today. We must recognize that in the human mind, there is no such thing as the past. In the human mind, the past is always present. And everything you do, every way you look at the world and relate to other people in the world, every way you interpret the world, the very way you move your body, the very way you talk, is the result of your historical experience. When we talk about the so-called black dialect or the way black people talk, it's just not merely a way we communicate with each other. The very way we speak, the very words we use, the very tonalities we speak reflect a history. Just talking to our children passes on a history to them. No matter what you are saying, your very voice represents the historical experience. I will talk a bit later on then to have you understand that the psychology of our children is different from that of the psychology of white children. The psychology you are studying in this college are incorrect and are going to make you dumber. And in many ways, with all your good intention, send you out to cripple these children and to cripple black people as a whole. Because the psychology of a people, just as the psychology of an individual, develops from the history and experience of that people, as they develop from the history and experience of the individual. To understand your own individual psychology, a person must understand your own history and experience. They cannot take the psychology of another person based on their history and experience and explain yours. Neither can you take the psychology of another people with a different history and experience and destiny and use that psychology to understand yourselves and to understand your children. And nor can you take that psychology and appropriately educate your children and direct your own destiny. It is impossible. And yet you have classrooms filled with general and introductory psychologists written by white men and women, and think you're learning some some neutral, non-political psychology. No such thing as a neutral and non-political psychology. There is no neutral and non-political course in this institution, and I'm talking even about physics, mathematics, and computer science. I heard some joke the other night, there is no black chemistry. There is no black physics. Lies. Lies. Because you must understand that chemistry and physics and mathematics and all flows from the consciousness and mind of man. They do not exist apart from that. That science flows from the political and social and economic organization of a people. Science just does not pop up in the minds of geniuses. People must exist in a particular political, social, historical context in order for science to develop and to flourish. And unless you know the historical, political context in which science is created and motivated, you will not create science. You will then educate some people who can think in science, and then those same people will be used by your enemies to destroy you and your children. If you saw the program the other evening about blacks in space, how many of you saw that Monday? To whom? To the enemy. So that enemy, taking advantage of those advanced cameras that they invented, taking advantage of the moon vehicles and so forth they invented, can from 500 and 600 miles out in space rain death and destruction on black people on this earth. And therefore, if you do not prepare the appropriate economic and political circumstances in which your children are to operate, they will be hired and be used to destroy you as an individual and to destroy you as people. And I will talk to you later on when you look at a Colin Powell who sits at the head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, so-called leading the American Armed Forces, and the very first time he leads the forces, he leads them against black people. How many of you saw 60 Minutes last week? Yeah. How many saw this colored lady sit there and defend racial discrimination? As a result of investigations in New York State, two black people exposed activities by major employment agencies, I mean tons of them in the state, who were through code discriminating against black people. And two black employees left those agencies because they were sick and tired of the discrimination that was going on. And of course you saw old Abrams there trying to take all the credit. What was it, Cosmopolitan Employment Agency? Yeah, owned by Norrell. And of course, the CBS crew ran a standard experimental deal where they made a resume, send a black woman, and then sent the white woman. And of course, you know the tale. No job for the black woman. And this white woman walked in 10 minutes later, jobs all over the place, even offered a cab fare to the interview, offered to walk into the subway, the whole bit. The woman vastly more qualified than the white woman. What is the white woman typing, what, 50 words a minute with 15 mistakes? Black woman, 72 words a minute, 3 mistakes. You know, that kind of stuff. And now they decide they will go to the spokesperson or whoever it was for the company, and lo and behold, who's sitting there to defend the company but a black woman? And it was a chilling experience to watch her whole body language, her whole expressionless face, and how far and abstracted she was from reality. As the announcer presented her with the memo, where the memo was talking about the practice, and she says, this is not on, she says, our letterhead is not on this memo. We are proud of our letterheads. How far is that from NASA as we sit? You haven't come from anywhere. You know, we are proud of our letterhead. And yet this kind of game goes on and on. And this is what you're headed for. And this, students, is what you are being prepared to do. You are being prepared to put a black face on white power and to defend white interest. And you must be ignorant of history or misread it in order to play this kind of game. And that's one of the reasons why they don't want it put in there correctly and have it correctly understood. Just read one part of something here for a second. And I use this illustration. Some of you who may want to see a more extensive discussion of this particular article in the Omni magazine, February 1984, titled Timeless Minds, you might want to get the lecture I delivered from Brother Brown here at the House of the Lord Church. What was it, 2 Wednesdays ago, I believe, where I talk about it. And then I discussed it more extensively at African Echoes over a year ago. And Brother Yusuf probably can cue you in on that. I'm just going to read only a fraction of this because it's so filled with meaning. It reads, "When I wake you, the past will be gone." Dr. Bernard Aronson of the New Jersey Neuropsychiatric Institute told a deeply hypnotized student. We discussed in that lecture I just mentioned at the House of the Lord about the fact that we as a people are in a chronic state of hypnosis. You're in hypnosis right at this moment. These classes that you're going to are hypnotizing you. And I talked about what hypnosis meant, and I impressed upon the people the fact that the essential ingredients of hypnosis was a social relationship, that is a hypnotist relating to the client in a particular way, you see, and the acceptance of that relationship by both parties, and the use of words. That was all. That was all. That's all that ever goes on in a hypnotic session, isn't it? Two people relating to each other in a social arrangement and words passing back and forth. Doesn't that adequately describe the classroom situation? Do you think you're merely sitting here and there getting information and knowledge? The very fact that you think that that is what's happening means you're hypnotized already. When the post-hypnotic suggestion took hold, the student became drowsy and infantile, losing both memory and the powers of speech. Later, he reported a vague sense of meaninglessness. What are we saying here? The hypnotist, by manipulating this man's attitude toward his past, manipulated his consciousness and real capacities and abilities. He just wasn't in a state of illusion. He had memory problems. He had problems getting meaning out of life. He lost his sense of purpose in life. He became lethargic and drowsy and sleepy, you know, fall asleep at night reading the books. Confused. In other words, then, the manipulation of history creates real effects in the individual's personality. So it is not an absence of knowledge that's occurring when you and I talk your history. You are put into a state of consciousness and many of your abilities are wiped out and destroyed as a result thereof. That is why your history is not being taught to you correctly, so that your potential will be forever undeveloped as a people and you will not challenge those people who rule over you. And even though this world is only ruled over by 10% of its population, the European, the other 90% in order to be ruled over must literally be out of their minds. You as a people have to be crazy to be in the position that you're in. Your state of consciousness has to be one that is deceptive, has to be one that is filled with lies and misinformation and misorientation. How can you inhabit the richest continents on this earth and be the poorest people living on it? How How can Japan, with no resources at all, be seen as the richest and most powerful nation on this earth, except that those people who have the earth's natural wealth see themselves as poverty-stricken and are poverty-stricken in their consciousness? You will see later on then that if the education doesn't wake you up from this, you are still going to be servants. You think perhaps that your ability to choose various courses at this school and other schools, your capacity now to choose whether you will be a computer scientist or this or that, means that you have advanced beyond your great-great-grandparents who were slaves. You have not advanced one bit. We don't have time to talk today about what I call the European constants. Those things that remain the same despite all the apparent changes that occur in the world. As a matter of fact, the changes that occur in the world are meant to maintain the very basic constants. Integration is not just an idea of black people. It is an idea pushed by the white ruling class. You have to understand that. It is to their advantage to run this game on black people's minds. You must understand that the slaves were not mere field hands and house servants. You had slaves with many skills, all types of skills. Carpenters and iron workers and millwrights and shipbuilders and you name it, they had it. Many did not just work on the plantations or in the house. They actually went out and followed professional jobs and bought the monies back to their slave masters. So the idea that you're picking up a skill does not advance you any farther than they were. Because in the end, the basic constant remains the same. And what is that constant? Working for someone else's profit. It does not matter that you are going to get degrees and whatever you get them in, you will still end up as your great-grandparents were, working for a white man and working for the benefits of other people without working for yourself. So then an education that does not liberate you from this, and in many times in history, ladies and gentlemen, slaves and servants educated their masters, but they were still slaves and servants. So knowledge alone will not free you. The development of skills alone will not free you. You must understand that you have to overthrow the situation that you're in. I demonstrated in the African Echoes lecture that it is the forgetting of our history that has robbed us of very practical skills. If you really forgot everything you learned in the past, you know you wouldn't know how to talk. You wouldn't know how to walk. You know that everything you operate on is something you've learned in the past. And forgetting that past means that you learn, you forget very practical abilities. This is the case with the people. The Koreans and other Asians and other groups are defeating African Americans in their own communities economically by using the oldest African economic techniques that's ever been around. But because we forgot our history, we forgot the techniques for raising monies to get control of our economic circumstances. You understand? So the forgetting of history was not merely a forgetting of heroes and how great we were. It was forgetting economic and other techniques. When you read the history of Shaka Zulu and others, you will learn political science. You will learn how to control nations and empires. You will learn what destroys nations and what maintains nations and groups. You learn then statecraft, administration. You learn all of those things because those things are embedded in the history of our people. When you look at the black family today, I see many people talking about the black family without first of all defining what the family is and what it's about. Starting a discussion assuming that a family is what Europeans say it is, without having any knowledge of the relationship between family and social and political circumstances and historical circumstances, without going back and studying the history of African families, because if you study the history, you will recognize that Africa presents a whole host of family styles and orientations from which we now, as a people, can choose so that we can create a strong black family today and tomorrow. This is real. This means children being loved. This means children being cared for. This means children being appropriately educated, children being fed, and so forth. So the knowing of that history and the understanding of that history is not merely then a celebration of lost heroes. It is essential to our very functioning and our very survival as a people. And it is essential, ultimately, to the overthrow of those who rule us. And they are more aware of it than are we. So we must understand the lessons of history, and we must study our past. What is the past? Where is the past? Is it nothing which was something? Is it something left behind, discarded, detached, forgotten, without influence, and thereby of no account? Does it or can it exist outside the mind and memory? Or is it not present in our genes? What I'm saying here in a minute, when I talk about black children are not children who happen to be black. The very color of your skin is a historical statement. It's just not a coloration. It represents hundreds and thousands of years of evolution. The very genes that you carry in your bodies are not merely the mechanism and biochemical means by which your body is maintained and shaped, by which you took on shape and form. Your genes contain the capsulized history of black people since the very beginning of time. The whole evolutionary, political, social, biological, geographical, climatological history of black people is contained right in your genetic structure. And therefore, our children carry the total history of black people right in their bodies today. And therefore, their blackness and their bodies then are not merely bodies that have been colored. Those bodies carry the history and existence of black people, the past, and they must carry the future. Or is it not present in our genes where we carry the evolutionary existence of our kind? And are we not then its present unfolding, evolvement and manifestation? Or is it not congealed in concrete and mortar, stone and steel, structures and pathways? Is it not still present in its negation, in its reconstitution, when it is transformed into something new? Isn't the new then something old? History, consciousness, unconsciousness, comprehended, uncomprehended, never ceases to be. It is only transformed, as transformation history is always here and now. Here today, there tomorrow. History is past, present, and future. It is destiny. If we will to transform destiny, we must will to transform history. I want to move rapidly into another segment here today where I wish to talk about revolution. And I am about revolution, and I am about preparing this race for a racial confrontation with those who now rule this earth. Because in this situation, it's either going to be those who rule or us, one way or the other. You want to hold on to your little dreams about little black boys holding hands with little black girls and white girls and so forth. You hold on to them. And then you're welcome to them, and you can die dreaming them if you wish. But let's try to wake up to a greater reality. To bring about, I indicate when I talk about black children and why I talk about a psychology of the black child. I mentioned the fact, as I've mentioned earlier, that the history of black people are different, therefore the psychology of black people is different. Consequently, if you're going to understand the psychology of black children, you have to understand the history of black people. And therefore, as I stated to you earlier, you cannot go into European psychology to deal with the psychology of black children. That's one reason why I wrote The Developmental Psychology of the Black Child. The other reason, of course, was the fact that the black child's body is not a duplicate of the European child's body. We are not colored people who are merely different according to the color of our skin. It's more to it than that, ladies and gentlemen. Your children represent the oldest race on this earth, the mother and father of all other of the races. They represent, as I told you earlier, that total history, their bodies as such. So they are not duplicates of white children. Another circumstance that I pointed out, how they are born intellectually more advanced than is the white child. They do things on their first day of life, the second day of life, that it takes a white child 6 or more months to do. They come out with the brain that, if you test it through EEG and other methods, demonstrates very clearly that they are more intellectually advanced than those of white children. You must understand, history is not merely something that happens to people. It becomes a total part of their body and their existence. And you must understand that history to understand your children. And it's the failure to understand that. I also demonstrate that history is not something that just occurs. We must study psychohistory. That is the psychological results of undergoing historical experiences. And to a very great extent, the problems with the education of black children, the crack epidemic, and all of these other things we complain about day in and day out, are the result of a psychology that flows from a particular type of historical experience. You have a school system that is based upon the psychology of white children and white people. And you are trying then to educate your children on the basis of that system. They are bound to fail. The very structure of this college itself is based upon a white model, and therefore it has a built-in failure mechanism for you, one way or the other. Because you don't understand that your historical experience has changed the very way you think, your very style of thinking, your very style of learning, your very style of relating one to the other has been transformed by your historical experience. Must understand. When you go into your psychology classes, you must understand that in order for the European to maintain his rulership over the world, even though he's 10% of the world's population, he must keep black people in a particular state of mind. It is necessary that you be backwards. It is necessary that this room be as sparsely attended today as it is with the College of the South. You must avoid things that have some meaning to you and flock toward things that are destructive to your future. Or else we wouldn't be oppressed, ladies and gentlemen. Don't you understand oppression? Rest on people going places and enjoying pleasures that destroy them, and who are excited by nonsense and bored by stuff that they should be learning. Don't you understand that is the foundation upon which the oppression of a people rests? You think that your being here, not being here, is an expression of your freedom of choice. It is an expression of your enslavement. In this world where things are backwards, those who are oppressed must feel freest when they are most enslaved. Yeah. And this is the result. But if you don't understand the history, people will say, well, why do we act like this? Why can't we get along? Why can't we do this? Why can't we do that? No people are born the way they should be for a culture. Every culture does what? Trains. Teaches its people to be what it needs to continue its existence. You cannot turn your children over to other people and turn yourself over to other people and expect to be the right people for yourself. You're out of your minds if you think so. Those people are going to educate you in their interest, and I don't blame them. Understand? You get run over by buses and tractors and everything to put your children in the hands of an enemy that tells you, I don't want to be bothered with them. I don't believe in them. I hate their guts. I intend for them to stay on the bottom forever. And you just make all kinds of sacrifices to push them in there. And then you wonder, they can't read. They can't write. They're so misbehaving. Don't you know you have to be in that position if you're to be ruled over? You think it's going to be the other way around? But somehow we try again and again to accomplish the same thing by the same failing means. Don't you know that is the premier sign of neurotic behavior? Doing the same thing over and over again, despite the fact that it fails time and time again, and your only solution is to try it harder and harder and harder. That's just the essence of neurotic behavior. And yet we fall for it. Every maladjustive characteristic that you find in the black personality, the inability to get along one with the other, the inability to be reliable in our relationships one to the other, the inability to trust each other, you see, the inability to really love each other well and deeply, the lack of self-confidence, the lack of self-acceptance, the rush we get from buying from other people other than ourselves and so forth, all of those things have been implanted in the personality, and they serve economic functions, and they maintain a power situation, ladies and gentlemen. They are not things that just happen to be in your personality. They have been instilled through a historical brainwashing into the personality. So that people can say, well, you're free to develop businesses, you're free to do this, but the problem is you don't trust each other enough, so you can't pull it together. And you have to understand then that a black psychology, an African-American psychology, must begin at the political necessity for African-Americans to be crazy, not with Pavlov's dogs. You must understand that even the demonstration of psychology in terms of dogs is a political game, right? You think when Skinner writes about rats and cats and rats and things like that, he's being non-political? Got another dog coming. You have to recognize that you are the rat. You understand? That your ghettos are the Skinner boxes. That the relationship between the experimenter and the rat is a power relationship. And the rat is conditioned because of the differences in power between the rat and the man. And that the rat becomes conditioned and changed as a result of the fact that the man has control of vital things in his life. And if you think you can let another people feed you and water you and clothe you and hire you and so forth, and they not transform you like that rat, you got another thought coming. And if you don't learn that in your psychology class, you are being made dumb. You must interpret, looking at that rat must be done politically. You don't only have to look at it in terms of he gets shot this time and the food drops in there that time and he puts it to the lever. That's education for dumb people. You'll make an A at that, but you'll still be dumb. In fact, the higher the grade you make, the dumber you'll be. If another people rest on your ignorance, and they do, then they will educate you into ignorance. You understand? While you're being taught one thing, you're ignoring other things. And therefore, in a sense, learning, while there's a gain in knowledge, is also a gain in ignorance. And therefore, you have to be careful about what you're learning. And so your mere learning, what these people are offering you here, is a problem. And you think because it's in the catalog, it must be important or it wouldn't be there. Got another thought coming. As our time is running out, I have to just get to the point here then. You must understand that the major enemy is white supremacy. You must understand that the education, even this introduction of the African curriculum into New York schools, while a step toward liberation, will not be fully liberating. Because it is not enough just to know history or any other thing. As I ask frequently, why are you going to school? For what purpose are you learning to read? For what purpose are you learning math? And of course, you'll quickly supply yourself with the answer, to get jobs. As if qualifying for jobs is going to represent your salvation. You must learn. The reason why I urge my students to engage in student activities and organizations is this, and that engaging in student activities and organizations is as important as what you learn. In fact, they're more important. Because it is not enough for you to qualify for a job and get a job. You must what? You must keep it. And that's where power operates. There are many unqualified people with jobs all over the place, but they know. Or they got power, or they have connections, or they got this. You think your mere qualifying for a job is going to secure your future forever? You got another thought coming. No way, ladies and gentlemen. You have to have the capacity to protect what you've gained. And that requires what? Power. Real power. Not another degree, you know? Real power. So don't be deceived by these things. You've been fooled into battles. You fought slavery, you fought Reconstruction, Jim Crowism, poor education, this battle, poor this, poor that, this. Do you recognize that all of these things represent one thing? What is that? White supremacy. If you rid yourself of white supremacy, then all of these other things you've been fighting for will take care of themselves. But without ridding yourself of white supremacy, you will have new battles to fight from now on and evermore, because it will constantly throw a new battle up for you. As a matter of fact, this society is going to become more supremely racist when it is apparently non-racist. And that's where it's moving to at this point. I used to tell my students, when a white man tells you, let's not put race in this, he's being the most racist at that point. One day I'll come back and explain to you this thing. Andy Rudy was fired the other day, suspended, for making a statement, we shall not have these kind of statements on CBS. Did that give black people any new jobs? Does that mean we came to own CBS? Not a damn thing was changed, but Rooney is sitting out cooling his heels. So then you can have a society that removes all public expression of racism. You can have a society where people no longer overtly express racial hatred, and racist statement and behavior is outlawed, but you can still have a system that destroys millions and millions of black people. Colin Powell and others are the signs of that kind of racism, where the black middle class would be sitting in these jobs and positions defending the system. You must recognize that racism is not an attitude. It is not a feeling of hatred toward another people. All of that's going to be washed out. You must understand that racism and white supremacy is in the very structures and values of the institutions of the society itself. And until you revolve and change those structures and attitudes and values, you will always be under the bottom. I don't give a damn if white people express no hatred toward you. I don't give a damn even. Let me end it here with this point. Why do we gather here this day to speak of revolution? That word which portends cataclysmic change and overthrow, the changing of the order of things. Why, we ask ourselves, we African Americans, must we speak of revolution at this day and time when peace and freedom are breaking out all over the Russias, the Balkans, and the spirit of unity sweeps like a refreshing breeze across Western Europe and the divided Germanies? When in South Africa, Mandela has thrown away his shackles, when in North America there is no longer the color line, where Jesse runs for president, Colin Powell marshals the world's mightiest war machine, a land where Dinkins and Maynard Jackson and Wilson Good and Smoke and Young and Bradley rule great cities, where Wilder governs a great state, where African men and women sit as ministers in presidential cabinets, don robes of justice, and take their places among the directors of America's global and multinational corporations, where Reginald Lewis places TLC on the Fortune 500. Why not speak of peace and brotherhood and of joining hands, of dreams, or at least keep silent and not cause undue alarm? And let those who are going for a swim in the mainstream rush headlong, unimpeded by a call to war. I speak of revolution. I beat the drums of war because one man, not a few famous men, are a people. The rule of one, the judgment, the generalship, the ministry, the captaincy of industry of one, of a few, is not the rulership of the people. The judging and generalship, ministry, captaincy of the people over themselves or over their destiny. The lives of a few heroes and heroines is not the life of a people. I speak of revolution because we have yet to have one, and our freedom and liberation must yet be won and secured. Our enemies yet rule us, and their numbers increase. Their strength grows exponentially. In our revelry, inebriated by our celebration of ephemeral victories, we have left our borders unwatched, our sentinels asleep at their posts. The enemy stealthily infiltrates our camps and prepares to slaughter us before we wake. For peace and unity among our enemies are joined in order to disturb the peace and unity among ourselves. We spoke easily of revolution in the 60s and 70s. We shouted from mountaintops and deep valleys, Black power. We raised our clenched fist toward the sky as if to threaten the heavenly host and vowed to march on till victory is won. Is victory won the reason we no longer sing our battle hymns? We no longer study war and have retired our uniforms and fallen out of our militant formations? As we lift our voices in hosannas and loudly give all praises due to our ancestors, our heroes past and present, as African men and women aspire to the highest offices and win seats at the tables of the mighty, the heroes and heroines of our future, the futures of our people, the carriers of our ethnic immortality, our young warriors, the mothers of our nations, the minds of our race fall like winter wheat before shop in sight of crack, dope, and AIDS. They are slain in the wombs of our mothers, their minds terribly wasted in schools mastered by their enemies. They kill each other, pulling the triggers of guns they cannot even manufacture. Their lives go up in smoke. The mayor of the nation's capital falls from his pedestal. Our salvation does not lie in being elected. This is the winter of our discontent. The written word is still perceived as an unintelligible cryptic hieroglyph by too many of our children. Basic mathematics still presents an insoluble riddle. Knowledge of self and self-love, self-confidence and doing for self still are the holy grails yet to be attained. While a few attain wealth, exploit opportunities which never knocked at our doors before, the multitude slip desperately into poverty, sickness, and disease, their lifespans shrinking faster than their horizons. Many in this land of plenty have no home, like the Son of Man, nowhere to lay their heads. The men rot in jail, 70% will be unemployed by the year 2000. Their unfathered sons die in the streets. Their daughters sell their souls to the highest bidders. Their children are bearing children. The people are becoming childish. Business Week, September 19, 1988. The cover screams, human capital decline of America's workforce. It whispers, as the economy comes to depend more and more on our women and minorities, we face a massive job of education and training. It wonders, can they be taught? It proposes, let's import new immigrants educated and trained to do the jobs. The New York Times, July 28, 1989. Blacks found lagging despite gains. The National Research Council, arm of the National Academy of Sciences and Engineers, nearing reports, racial discrimination is only one of several barriers to the improvement for the nation's 30 million blacks. But the other barriers are not mentioned. Full integration of blacks into a colorblind society is unlikely in any foreseeable future, largely because of the existing social and economic separation. They say if all racial discrimination were abolished today, the life prospects facing many poor blacks would still constitute major challenges to the public policy. Do you understand what I'm trying to tell you? The mere so-called removal of racial barriers is not going to remove 15 to 20 million black people from dying in this country, ladies and gentlemen. The removal of apparent racism is a setup for your death. Do not you understand what is going on? Do you not understand the chief American dilemma? That dilemma is this: how do you destroy a people while appearing to care for them at the same time? And you can see it working itself out as such. You destroyed them by making it appear that they are destroying themselves. And you'll even get these old black middle classes, of which too many of you are going to become a part, who will sit back and try to blame the victim and talk about how they don't have motivation, how they are raised by broken families. Broken families are not the reason for the failure of black children. You must understand that. And teenage pregnancy and so forth are not the basis for the miseducation of black children. Don't believe that lie. But as I've told you before, in order to be in the condition you're in, you must be backwards and take the lies for truth and truth for lies. That's the only way it can happen. Is the dream becoming a nightmare? The chairman of the Xerox Corporation calls it the making of a national disaster. Former chairman of Procter & Gamble Company fears the creation of a third world within our own country, as if we didn't have one already. Chief Executive Officer of Johnson & Johnson says it is the American dream turned nightmare. The Times went on to warn the students who are most at risk are children from minority groups, the same youngsters who will fill 56% of the new jobs that will open up between 1986 and the year 2000. If we played this game right, we could take this country. I'm telling you. We could take it. Many of these African people try to say, oh, Lord, I ain't gonna do nothing to America. I'm going back to Africa. You don't have to go back to Africa. Have you ever thought about taking this one over? You're in the position to do so, ladies and gentlemen. But you must wake up to the possibilities and how this can be accomplished. That this is why you're being miseducated, so you can't see this kind of thing occurring. Remember the movie Planet of the Apes? Yeah, a symbolism. One day the H1 woke up and realized that they were doing the majority of the jobs, that the whole system was based on their labor, and they asked themselves, why then must we be slaves and servants when we can be the rulers of the system? Don't you know you're in the same position today, ladies and gentlemen, the young men and women? You don't have to prepare for a position of service in this system. Don't you know that if you understood international politics and other things, you could take over this nation itself? Does that frighten you? Live with it. America is developing into it. America is developing into a nation of educational haves and have-nots who are fast becoming unemployment haves and have-nots. This polarization follows racial lines, and the effect on the economy and the country could be devastating. Is this the promised land our prophets saw from the mountaintop? The Times heralded on Monday, September 25th, 1989. On the 29th, they reported employment agencies have discriminated against job applicants who are black, Hispanic, female, and deemed too old to hire by systematically steering them away from jobs that have been reserved for whites. And the principal targets were black. Flashback, Newsweek, February 22nd, 1988, $2. Special report, the Pacific Century, is America in decline? Remember when the price of cotton went down, the number of blacks hung went up. When this country, that integration and so forth can only work during economic prosperity. When this country declines economically, you will see changes in racial attitude. I don't care what kind of laws you have. I ask, is the mainstream drying up? Somewhat more ponderously, I ask, are we to remove the foot of white racism from our necks, only to have it replaced by that of the Asian economic juggernaut? Ouagadougou, Burkina Faso, January 29th, Pope John II arrived today in the struggling land and begged affluent nations not to scorn Africa's hungry millions. How, he pleads, would history judge a generation that, having all the means to feed the earth's population, refused to do so with fratricidal indifference? The earth is becoming sterile across an immense area. Malnutrition is chronic for tens of millions of people. Too many children die, he cried. Is it possible that such a need is not being felt by all humanity? Is it possible, I say, that a people who complacently watch my African brothers perish, who help them and watch the people who help them along their path of death, would not kill me also? I am an African. The death of my brother is also my death. Let me put this question to you again, because many foolish black middle classes and many foolish people who are eating well think that they can sit in America and watch this country destroy the African continents, and watch this country destroy African Caribbeans, and watch this country destroy Africans in Central and South America, and think that these same people who destroy Africans abroad will not be the same people who will destroy them in America. There are fools in this country who try to claim that they are not Africans, who claim that they do not see color, as if their not seeing color makes any difference in the world. Simply because you don't see color doesn't mean somebody does not see you as color, and that's the issue. And you think then that you can sit in this country while this same nation and these same people that you sleep with and marry and love and so forth can go out and destroy African people and not think those people do not see you as African, even though you choose not to see yourself as African. You'd better think again. You're out of your minds and you're headed for death. You must understand that. Hide behind these. I am an American. I am a human being. Ladies and gentlemen, these death and destruction of black people will follow those kind of abstractions. We don't call them black poor anymore. We call them the underclass. Right? The hardcore unemployed. The other night on Channel 13, they called them the throwaway people. No racial name hooked into it. They talk about, and you what you call, and we get these bunch of people who want to identify black progress with their getting jobs. You know, there are only about 700,000 black people in this country making over $50,000 a year. Yeah, over $50,000 a year. 700,000. Imagine that against 35 million people. Don't you understand? You're getting jobs, and these few little thousand people getting jobs doesn't represent a thing. It's a drop in the damn bucket. They say one third of black people are below the poverty line. Do you recognize what that means? That's 15 million people. And when you talk about $50,000, which is no money in today's world, you're talking about all the rest of us folk. You understand? But now it'll be put in abstract statistics, talk about the underclass and this kind of business, and see the name won't be attached to it, so that you won't feel emotionally connected as such. Wake up, wake up. We must deal with this. And so here the Pope is pleading about Africa. Flashback times, January 16, 1990, Washington. For the senior officers who serve as instructors at the nation's top level military school, teaching what they know is no longer enough. Now they find that threat, that is from the Soviet Union, is growing more ambiguous by the day, and say that war games portraying the Soviet Union as the aggressor are increasingly irrelevant. People don't know, I wish you, you're at this college. Do you know there are war colleges where people just go like you go to study war, where they move armies and resources and things across maps of Africa and other places, ladies and gentlemen? You have to be aware of that. Now they're saying, due to the changes in Russia and Eastern Europe, we're going to have to change our war college curricula. And we're going to have to make new enemies and restructure our situation. They said the Soviet Union, as an aggressor, are increasingly irrelevant. The threat is no longer the Russians, said Captain John H. Haidt of the Navy School. The threat is uncertainty. The Russians are out, and the Third World is in, said Lieutenant Colonel Paul Pugh. Don't you know you're on the board? Don't you know that foray into Panama is going to be a foray into the islands, is going to be a foray into Africa, and ultimately a foray into your very house? It is no accident that as Dinkins gets elected, and they are grooming Powell for a vice presidency, making him an honorary white man, that at the same time you're talking about black men as being what? An endangered species? This is the American dilemma. This is the American contradiction. It has been played time and time and time and time again. When are you going to learn it? At the very point when you reach the highest offices in this land, is going to be the very point your people are going to die by the thousands in the streets of this country. And therefore, you cannot identify your progress with the elections of some officer. You must keep your nose to the ground and see what the hell is going on. That's exactly the game they want you to play, to lift you up and chop you down one and at the same time. And this is occurring. It's no accident. It has always occurred that way. Because, ladies and gentlemen, these so-called civil rights programs were designed to assuage the white conscience so that their killing of black people could continue in good conscience. That's all it was about. Not about the change in the situation. You got to look at consequences, not intentions. And this is what we fail to do. Our people are dying. Our people are yet downtrodden, near level to the ground. It is not yet Uruhu. It must be revolution, or it will be death. And I intend to live. For the tyrant still sits on the throne. His reign of terror, like a bellowed wildfire, sweeps across the cities, towns, and villages, crackles the trees of the forest, and incinerates the farmlands of our people. He is the tyrant. He is the tyrant of a thousand faces. All of them we know. Sometimes they smile. Sometimes they frown. Sometimes they are serious. Sometimes they clown. Sometimes they yell, we're slaves. Other times they say, we are free. But the one thing they try to keep from us is that they are all one face, the face of white supremacy. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Questions. If you're going to class, don't rush out. This educational experience is more important than anything you can get after you leave that door. So please, can we have maybe a couple of questions?
Yes. Yes.
Have you published anything recently, and where are you, and how
can
you
get in touch with you? April, I will have two publications out, one on black-on-black violence, which is essentially ready now, and another dealing with enhancing the intelligence of black children, and the third one dealing with European psychology and the diagnosis of black clients. Around the end of summer, I will do a book on the education of black children and lay out an outline of what Afrocentric education is about and deal with the concept of intelligence. Because one of the major problems I've tried to point out in other forums is that we have misidentified and defined what intelligence is. And we've defined intelligence as black people has the kind of capacity that allows us to solve other people's problems and not our own, which is what you're being trained to do in this school and other schools today. And the more you're able to solve their problems, the more intelligent you will become. But it's the wrong game. And I will demonstrate how the essence of intelligence is the ability to adapt to one's circumstances and change those circumstances to one's convenience and survival. There is no other definition of intelligence. Intelligence is not measured by numbers and achievement test scores and all the rest of the nonsense that you have been given. Intelligence that is not applied to your survival as a people is not intelligence, you know, in no kind of shape, form, or fashion. And you have to understand it, but you must understand that intelligence is guided by the recognition of the existence of a problem. The mind organizes itself in terms of a problem to be solved. It then starts to collect the relevant information for the solution of the problem. It then coordinates that information and organizes it and processes it and expresses it through the behavior of the individual so the problem can be solved. The major problem that we have today as students and as a people is that we don't recognize that we have a problem. And when you do not recognize that you have a problem, you have no means of organizing your minds. And one of the major reasons then your children are having difficulty in the schools is because they have no problem to solve. And they ask you, why am I studying this, Mama? What's the reason? I need to know this. You got to offer them more than, oh, so you can get a job. It's beyond that. So yes, they'll be coming out soon. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to ask a question regarding Christianity, because I myself am a Muslim Christian, and mm-hmm. I cringe when I see a white image of Jesus, which is a lie, and I cringe when I hear a white man trying to tell me about God. And so my Christian brothers tell me it's the word and that your attitude is very limited and narrow, and I'm saying mm-hmm. no. If we start out with the premise of a lie, your conclusion can be, the only result is your conclusion is a lie. So if we start mm-hmm. out with Jesus being white, what else have they tempted?
You can get
No, I know that. I know that, but I'm saying it's an institutionalized.
As a matter of fact, if you say,
well, excuse me, our time is limited. Let's let Brother Wilson answer the question. Well, okay, then if we want to discuss it later on, we can. Okay, but let's make use of. Let's think of that.
Okay, of course that's a complicated question, and it takes a certain form of time we have here today. But one of the things that we have to understand very clearly is to distinguish between the religion as a concept and as a practice and the use of religion. Many times, speaking of history, and I think this is history we should remember, many times we forget as black people that we did not come over on these ships as Christians. Yeah. And many people, you have to stop and meditate that. You know, it's very important that you meditate that, you know. Because, you know, we talk about how mom and them prayed with the pot over the head and all that. Well, that's fine, too. But there was a period before that. And the African continent was not practicing Christianity prior to enslavement. I know that hurts some of your feelings, but you got to deal with it. Okay? Then once you recognize that, you then got to ask who taught it to you. And for what reason?
Thank you.
You understand? Thank you. Now, that's not attacking your Jesus and that. That's separate from that. I'm trying to get you to understand a use situation. That's why I said earlier, you must study the history of empires. Why did Ghana fall apart? Why did Mali fall apart and so forth? One of the interesting things I think for the downfall of some of the African empires was the fact that often these empires collected groups and tribes who were permitted to maintain their own religion, identity, and everything else. So there's always a centrifugal force operating in that kind of empire. As soon as the people get a chance, they're going to get out of the deal. Or as soon as the empire is weakened from the outside, they fly out. But the Arabs and the Europeans learned something very crucial. Give them your religion, give them your culture, give them all the whole bit, man. And they'll hang in there voluntarily no matter what you do. And so you must understand, while the practice of Christianity may be one thing, its use is another. And you have to examine your religious practice to see if you're not practicing it in a way that it permits the use of you as a people and to permit your continued enslavement as a people. And I would argue to a good extent, as it is projected and interpreted by whites, it is projected and interpreted in ways to maintain white power. You got a people who stole everything from you and then turn around and talk to you, what? Thou shalt not steal. You know, they sat right there in Bensonhurst, killed black people, and then walked right into the church and had preachers. Now, be angry, but sin not. What a joke that must have been for Cox and the rest of those whites sitting up in that auditorium. Look, isn't this religion working, man? You kill them, and then they use it to maintain themselves in position. You must read the Bible with your own eyes. Many of you don't even read the Bible. You read into the Bible, and you read into it what other people have told you. Now, one of these days, I'm going to give you a lecture on Moses and the whole political science of Moses. You see, you must understand that, and this is why the Jew, less than 3% of the population of the United States can manipulate this country, because throughout that Old Testament is a whole series of lessons in the manipulation and control of people. Do you recognize that those children from Israel were not believers in Jehovah when they left that land? Despite all the painting on the wall of blood, all of those things that God did for them, they were still disbelievers. How do you know that? If they weren't, Moses wouldn't have to go up on the mountain and bring back a religion to them. And when he got back, they were still down there praising their slave gods, right? And then, do you know what he did after that? How do you remember that? He called up and said, those who go with me, who believe what I believe, step up here. And those who don't stay there, he slayed how many? 3,000, right on the spot. Read this there. You mean you didn't see that while you were reading all of that? Why did he slay them, ladies and gentlemen? Because we cannot deal with disunity. We have too many trials. And we had too many things to undergo. And those people who are creating disorder in the system must be removed. It's not just about worshiping gods and so forth. How many times was Moses nearly hung and lynched by those people? Read it for real. How many of you recognize that Moses killed 24,000 people? Huh? Oh, you claim you know the Bible, don't you? Why did he kill them? For going with foreign women, the Midianite women, right? Huh? Killed them right on the spot because he recognized that not only were they hanging out with these women, they were in taking into themselves foreign ideologies and other things that also would destroy the nation if it went too far. And they had to chop 24,000 of them away. And one of the leading princes went out and dapped into their meeting with the foreign woman on his hand, on his arm. And Moses' assistant jumped up and killed both of them right on the spot. And you know what happened? God rewarded them for doing it. Learn something for a change. But you've been given this old Moses deliver me kind of religion that has been designed to maintain you in a state of servitude. Reread it and learn for real what is going on in the world. Our time is up. Did you want one more? Okay, one more.
One little one. This brother had his hand up. Be brief and
There is a saying that a house that divides among itself shall never stand.
Right.
I'm talking this, you know, about the relationship between African Americans and Africans scattered all over the world.
Yes.
The white man brainwashed the African American that they were sold by the African at home. Most of them still believe on it.
Okay. In the current book that's coming out, Black on Black Violence, of course, and this is what Black on Black Violence is about in part, the attitudes of antipathy that exist among us as people and therefore move us toward the murder and killing of one another and at the least of not cooperating one with the other. And of course, this has to be the case, as I said earlier, in order for this system to remain in power. Once we understand, and this is the value of understanding the psychohistory of a people, and by the way, African Americans are not the only ones who have been brainwashed. This system is a global system that we are dealing with. The brainwashing has occurred to black people all over the globe. You see, that's why I tell some other black people want to run to Africa so quick. You think you're going to get away from the white man by running to Africa? You got another thought coming. The white man is everywhere. This is a global system that you're dealing with here. And therefore, this brainwashing has been wholesale. Now, Chinwezu, who wrote the book The West and the Rest of Us, will argue and does argue that Africans on the continent did participate in the selling of Africans to the slavers. And I do not see the rejection of that as necessary for me to understand the issue, because people sell their own people out. That it occurs today. It occurs in Africa today. You got Mobutu and a whole bunch of other rascals over there selling out whole nations of African people to white interests. And this kind of game has been going on since that particular point. And today you got the black bourgeoisie in America, in all of its little old tiny jobs and status, selling out the bulk of African people. And this is the truth that we must face. And it is not something we need to be ashamed about or get into a big fight about. It is a thing that we must look at and decide how we will not let this occur again. Because I do a thing in this previous book about the idea that the white children must pay for the crimes of their ancestors, okay? And every time they get stabbed and mugged out here, they pay in for the original crime of ancestors and so forth, ladies and gentlemen. And this must be dealt with. But you also have the issue that black people are mugged more than white folk. And more black people killed by other black people than white folk, that are killing white folk and so forth. That too flows from betrayals in our past as people. And denying them and trying to cover over them is not going to solve the problem. Because until whites repent and reparate the sins of their fathers, they will continue to die and suffer. And until we face the reality that some of our people participated in this slave trade and deal with the betrayal of our children today by black adults, we are going to continue to suffer and our children will suffer. And the thing that we have to recognize then, that in the education of African children, you have to recognize once you understand what history has done to us, then you know what your educational curriculum is about. It must be about restoring those characteristics and knowledges and forms of relationships that have been stolen in order that the white man remains supreme. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. this morning, didn't we?
Not in the deepest sense, but as approximations, they're not bad.
Let me hear your question. You want to just sit that?
Yes.
Yes, my question is, all along we talk about power.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I, the way I understood it, power is money, right? And
to a certain extent.
Yeah. So,
well, okay, go ahead.
So if there is a case, I really want to know if there is a way, if there's something that the African American are doing,
mm-hmm.
like to bring all the black, at least rich people together under one umbrella,
mm-hmm.
to form establishment like bank system from which we can get our own schools, get our own hospitals.
Right. No, not at this point. First of all, we have to understand, I think that's going to have to be done by a relatively small group of black people who are not rich. Okay? Because you have to recognize that the rich black people are more imprisoned by the system and more dedicated to maintaining it than people who are not rich. For instance, you look at Johnson Publication, right? A man that's maybe worth $600,000 to $700,000, right? But you look at his magazine and notice how bland and non-offensive it is. In a sense, he can't say what I say because he's going to insult all the white advertising people. So he cannot be associated with the kind of enterprise that you are speaking of. So this stuff is going to have to be developed from another ground. The other thing is we have to recognize that, of course, money does not make an economic system. An economic system ultimately is based on the nature of the social relations between people. And it's not that blacks, as people have no money, black people in this country, for instance, are the 9th or 10th richest nation on this earth. And so it's not the absence of money, it's the fact that the social organization of black people and the nature of their social relations are such that this money cannot be systematically distributed and used. As such. And so the main problem becomes, first of all, establishing the necessary social relations and social organizations rather than, you know, a mere bring together many people, you see. And as a matter of fact, with that organization and relations, we can do so much even without a lot of money, you see, as such. But this will require major redefinitions of what an economy is and what it's really about. The black rich, so-called, essentially are going to be the ones who protect the system. And they have the greatest stake in it, as it is. And they think it is right, as it is. And of course, as it is, it necessarily negates the large percentage of black people. That's what I mean, again, by abstraction, the more abstract it becomes. See, they will only talk about making money. You see, but what I'm talking about is the making of money in the process of overthrowing European power,
mm-hmm.
you know, which is a whole different purpose for economic organization. Because if you just talk about making money, then the system doesn't really become a threat to you. And in fact, you are vested in the system staying as it is. The only thing you're looking for an opportunity to make it. But you have to recognize that the very organization of the system itself is racist, you see. But what they do is call their organization standard business practices, you see, and make us think that they're not racist and made it rich. Black people who got rich on that abstraction, of course, would protect that abstraction. And so we have to understand that. For instance, I think the other night about interest rates. and how interest, we think of interest rate merely as being the cost of money.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how much money costs, right? Without recognizing that interest rates really represent a value system. A system of values. You see, for instance, when you talk about the Japanese, you know what they'll say about the Japanese? Well, they say Japanese can move ahead of us because their money is cheaper. Right, they have lower interest rates.
That's what y'all said.
Right, and that's a part of the truth. It's easier to get money. I'm trying to get a $300,000 loan now. You know how much I have to pay back in interest on that loan? $419,000. In addition to the $300,000. So in order to use $300,000, I must pay back $719,000 for the use of that money. So if you just took the system as it is,
even without race, it's going to cut me right down into the ground. You see, so, and that's what these rich people are going to say. Now, what's going on here with that? One of the reasons why interest rates are so high is that Americans want to get rich quick. They don't want to wait. And this is what they'll tell you, too, about the Japanese. They're not in a hurry to get rich. They're willing to wait a much longer period of time for a return on their money, which means then that the interest rate is down. And therefore, they can borrow money much more cheaply and move much more rapidly. But where you got a bunch of greedy people, you see, and impatient people, and people who all want to get rich overnight, interest rate is up here, you see. But it isn't talked about in terms of greed or talked about in terms of, you know, attitudes. It's always just talked about as a market force, as if it has nothing to do with people's minds and attitudes. You see what I'm saying? So when we talk about a system, an economic system, you recognize we have to redefine all of those concepts. And essentially, we would have to, with guys like yourself, you've got to sit down and decide that you're going to organize your system and take it over and forget about these other guys. You understand what I'm saying?
I have one more question. But we the youth from Africa, mm-hmm. we realize that our brothers, African American here, have got a lot to offer to us.
Right.
And then I would like to know if there is a room that can accommodate us, mm-hmm. that we can be one, mm-hmm. so that if we become mm-hmm. the rulers
mm-hmm. yes.
of Africa, mm-hmm. at least we would we'll have some kind of, mm-hmm. There will be a room.
It's not intended, though.
I'm mm-hmm. retired in South Africa.
Go ahead.
Is there any room? Are you preparing any platform?
I am. I'm creating a club right now that involves itself with that kind of strategic thinking and development in terms of what you're, you know, in terms of what you're talking about. Because I think one of the major problems is that African leaders, and it's deliberately designed so that brothers like yourself can be in contact with the brothers on this side, so that as you return home and move up, and it's deliberately set up so that brothers from the Caribbean, yourself, here, will be the ones that move up into positions, so that when we get into positions, we run the program. Okay, now that's being developed by me, and I'm going to turn you on to that, because one of the problems I've had, and a number of us have, with the current African leadership now, is getting them to invest in the development of black business and black economic development, because they do not, I don't think, quite yet realize the vital importance that African Americans represent to the development of Africa. Let me give you one quick illustration. I used to have a bookstore and a business office supply company, right? And I used to lament the fact that I couldn't buy even a pencil that said made in Africa, made in Nigeria, whatever. Not even a gem clip, you know, not even the simplest item. It's either made in China, Taiwan, this place, that place. And all of these things have been the basis of the development of their technological economies, right? We are the largest majority in this country. Yet the products of minority groups in this country are flooding the country. Now, what's that in part the result of? Because we ourselves have not politically organized so that we can use our political strength to lay favored nation status upon our African nations across the sea, which is what we must do and come to understand that, so that your manufacturer can get into this country. Because a lot of people don't understand, you just can't manufacture a product and you're gonna sell it anywhere. It has to be permitted mm-hmm. to be sold. And we have to face the reality that the prosperity of our countries, of African nations, still relies upon the opening of the American market. And one of the major functions of the African Americans is to open this market to your manufacturer. And once you open that market to your manufacturer, that stimulates your economic and technological growth and development. And that means then that Africans on the continent must support the political development and economic development of Africans on this continent as a way of, you know, of resolving the economic issues on the African continent itself.
You see? Now, whites know this. If you read the report done by Brzezinski under the Carter administration, a very famous memo where they deliberately recognized this and were determined through a series of activities to separate the black middle and radical classes from the African continent. And they enumerated the various steps by which they do it, one of which was the election of blacks to political office.
To pass the financial.
You know,
feel glad.
So that they would, and supporting black business persons and supporting appointments of blacks to high offices so that those people would feel that as if they have a stake in the system as it is and defend that system against other blacks and at the same time serve to maintain Africa in this position, you see. And so you, brothers like yourself and others, we are forming an organization. We are looking now for a clubhouse so that this kind of interchange and strategic thinking will occur.
Can you extend this to school? Because already, because of this motive we have in mind, the Africans in this school have started to form a club, and we have not yet even submitted it. So when we heard of it, we decided to come and then share this view with you. If you wouldn't mind, because what you are discussing with us is what we are for.
Yes.
If we can use, if we can be part of the organization being established in this college.
Okay, give me a call. And I'll be happy to work with you on this. And what's your name again?
Roger Fiambetu.
Do you live here in the Bronx?
No, in Manhattan, Harlem. I live in Harlem.
Okay, well, that's, you know, right across.
You live downtown too, right?
Well, actually, I'm just a few blocks away.
Yeah,
I stayed off the building because, you know, I used to own a business down there. And I will still be back. Give me a call very soon, Roger. And I'll let you know what's going on in that work.
Strong, like, staunch revolutionary. I mean, you feel like sometimes you, like, kind of beating your head up against a wall.
Being, all
like
the
you
time.
Said, like, the small turnout.
All the time.
You know, that it would ever be a possibility of a physical, you know, revolution. Mm-hmm. Or you think black people over here, because when I talk about black
that is ring it once, hang up, call back. That's what it says.
They yeah, it's taboo yeah. When I talk about black revolution. Most blacks, you don't want to hear it. So I'm saying, you ever feel there'll be a physical, you know, actual physical revolution about in time?
Yeah, you have to recognize one, certainly, as I said earlier, see, those attitudes have to be in place to maintain the system. When I said you're only free to do the wrong thing, we only have freedom of speech in this country because this country knows that the majority of people will not listen to you. So you're given the illusion of freedom of speech because it is structured, the mentality of the largest percentage of your people such that either they're not interested in what you're saying, they're bored by what you're saying, or they don't understand what you're saying. Okay? But you have to recognize that it only takes a relatively small group of people to do a revolution.
I just don't know what keeps
I could
going.
See right now, I could see 10 or 20 good men moving us to a revolution and taking over economically many places right now.
Right.
Definitely. Because you see, many of the people, you have to understand how people are changed. In this backward world, the people who should be here will not be here. That's the way it maintains itself, right? But you have to understand how people are changed. People are changed in terms of the concrete conditions under which they live. So we, as revolutionaries, must understand we have to do very concrete things. And so whereas those people will not listen to a lecture or put up with it, they're running against the concrete reality that we create, transforms them. See, that's the reason why I used to tell some of the organizations that do a lot of lecturing that, look, if you owned 125th Street, you wouldn't have to lecture to the kids. Your very ownership and control of it transforms their whole sense of who and what they are about as a people. That's why the nationalist has to build in concrete and mortar there, you see. But when you let other people control the time you go to work and come home and all those other times, they don't have to lecture at you for 2 or 3 hours on the weekend. They already shape your very consciousness itself. So then in terms of transforming the people, it must be about transforming their concrete condition. You must show that you can deliver the goods, that your ideology translates into power and into prestige and freedom. To merely give them erudite lectures and so forth, they're going to go to sleep on you and they should.
Yes. Yeah, I would like to, my question. I don't know if it's a question. Maybe I'm looking for a solution. I'm having, I question those students who don't have a difficult time sitting in front of a teacher that's doing this hypnotics.
I have difficulty with it.
And I'm having, being a psychology major, I'm having the most difficult time dealing and sitting. And what bothers me, I'm sitting in the front of the class, but I know that this hypnotic process is going on between the other students outside of myself, and looking at this Jewish professor bringing her history and constantly bringing it in, and I'm recognizing and I'm